Elizabeth Carpenter graduated from Earlham College with a bachelor's degree in elementary education. Mrs. Carpenter taught in a variety of educational settings before coming to Towson State College in 1969 as a teacher at Lida Lee Tall, and then as a faculty member in the Department of Early Childhood Education. These are her reflections.
Mrs. Carpenter, thank you for sharing with us your thoughts about your teacher preparation and your subsequent career in education. You are helping us enrich our understanding of teacher education at Towson University, and this will add greatly to our story. I think a good place to begin is in the beginning. So would you share with us your early social context, where you grew up, what you were thinking as you got older in terms of a possible further education or career?
Okay, well, I was born on the second floor of 1413 Decatur Street in Locust Point and lived there until I left the house to be married when I was 26 years old. So the community was very, very much a part of my entire life. At that point, the community was, I would say, at least 70 or more percent farm-born and first generation. So all the children I went to school with, almost all of them, were children whose parents spoke another language other than English, and who went to what was a very unusual school, which I wish I had time to talk about it at some point. It was what in the 1970s was being looked at as a community school and a community center, and here it was back in the early 1930s that Persis K. Miller, who I'm sure was a Towson grad, had established that kind of a community school. My point is that the mixture, the ethnic mixture, and the guidance of that wonderful, wonderful principal was quite unique and unusual. And Miss Miller, she was, expected all of us to go just as far as we could, and she set no limits for us. But since the families were large and the community's expectations in terms of, you know, how can I, an immigrant, come to this country and expect that my child's going to become a doctor? If he gets through high school, that would be wonderful. And so we all aimed for high school. And many of us didn't make it, and many of us did, and went beyond high school. But the community itself was a wonderful community to grow up in, and it was a community that really, despite the fact that many, many families drew their children out of school, as soon as they were 14 years of age, so that they could go to work and help raise younger brothers and sisters, there still was a love of learning and a respect for education and a respect for the community and teachers in the community that I've never found anywhere else. It was just remarkable. It's remarkable.
So here you are in high school and having the opportunity to complete high school. How is it possible that you found a way to go on to college?
Well, you know, let me just say, I think we all believe that dancers and athletes and artists are born. I truly believe teachers are born too. You're born wanting to teach. And the respect that I had for that school and the teachers and my father and mother's love of learning and education, even though they did not think that I'd go beyond high school, was such that I knew, I think from day one, that I wanted to be a teacher. I did. If I played with dolls, it was only to use them as students. They weren't weren't babies. They were students to me. And so I wanted it all my life. And When I was ready for high school, another friend and I petitioned the Baltimore school system to let us go to Eastern High School rather than Southern, which was our local school. Uh-huh. And it was almost unheard of to have anyone go out of their school district, but the school system allowed us to go to Eastern High School because they had an academic program there, uh-huh. and they didn't have one at Southern. Mm. So my friend Anna Melissa went into nursing, and I kept on working toward, I knew I was going to teach somewhere, somehow, mm-hmm. someday I would teach. But when I graduated, it was during the war years, and mm-hmm. I got a job as a draftsman assistant for the Baltimore Gas and Electric Company. And I pinched pennies and put away everything that I could. And by the third year after high school, I couldn't stand it any longer. I had to go learn to be a teacher. And so I took my money and I asked my church for a loan of some kind. Mm-hmm. It was very small, but they gave me a little bit. And I had, when I put it all together, I had enough for one semester. And I went off and I was able to get enough work at school to see me through and enough scholarship then that I was able to get through those 4 years.
Wow.
Four happiest years of my life.
And where did you go?
I went to Earlham College in Richmond, Indiana. Uh-huh. It's a small, Quaker liberal arts college.
Uh-huh. And did they have a teacher prep program?
A very, very small program. Uh-huh. Actually, there was one teacher in the entire teacher prep program. But he was a wonderful man and a fine teacher. And it was a good program. And in Indiana at that time, instead of having one term of student teaching, as we have here at Towson, we had a whole year of student uh-huh. teaching.
Interestingly, yeah. I think most programs now here at Towson, at least K through 8, mm-hmm. put students in schools for a whole year.
Great.
So
I'm glad to hear that. I think it's wonderful.
Right. But isn't it interesting, though, that you found this way before Towson committed to doing it? That's very interesting.
It was, yeah.
And so what kinds of experiences did you have as part of your preparation in school? I mean, did you just observe initially, or?
Actually, we didn't. We just were dumped into student teaching.
Oh, okay.
But again, it was a small enough program and a small enough consortium of students. And with that wonderful instructor that we had, mm-hmm. we spent a lot of time after class hours in the library. There was a room set aside where people could just sit and hang out and, mm-hmm. and talk. And we had a number of seminars and things of that kind that we did on our own, sharing experiences. Mm-hmm. And I did a lot of babysitting. Does that count?
So, helps.
Yeah, it helps.
So what grade levels did you, I mean, were you involved? Was it an elementary program or?
No, believe it or not. I had always wanted to teach history in high school.
Oh.
And my degree is in secondary ed, really.
I didn't know that.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And it was when I had my own children that I realized where the real action was and where I really wanted to be.
Uh-huh.
I mean, have always found 5-year-olds to be far more intellectually stimulated than most of my college students. Not all of them, most of them.
So you completed this degree, and mm-hmm. did you then come home to Baltimore?
Yes, I came home to Baltimore, and I applied for my teaching certificate and found I was short a couple of courses, and I can't really remember right now exactly what they were. One of them was Maryland history.
Oh, of course.
That was not an obstacle that I couldn't have overcome very easily. But it was 1949, the post-war years, and we were still struggling with McCarthyism in this country. And I found that the Maryland legislature had passed a bill saying no one can teach in the schools of Maryland who had any kind of communist affiliations. And they needed to sign a statement to that effect. And Well, I have no communist leanings. They'd find me too difficult to work with, I think. But I did have some strong reservations, conscience reservations, about signing a statement, having to sign that statement. Uh-huh. And believe me, it was a struggle. Yeah. I'd waited all this time, mm-hmm. But I couldn't do it. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't teach.
So what did you do as an alternative?
Well, I had a strong sociology background, uh-huh. and I went to work for the YWCA as a social worker, uh-huh. and worked there for 4 years, I guess. Mm-hmm. And then married, mm-hmm. and then had my own children, and became very much interested in early childhood education, and started taking courses here at night. Uh-huh. And then my first job was, I was hired by the Mount Washington Parent Cooperative.
Okay.
So parent cooperatives were just beginning to be become resources for parents, and I became fascinated by the thought of working closely with parents and young children all at the same time. Mm-hmm. So I became involved in that, and I was hired as a teacher at Mount Washington Co-op, and then moved from there steadily into the early childhood programs.
Mm-hmm. And how old were your children when you started that?
Oh, let me think.
But they were they of an age that they would participate in that co-op? Were they part of that too?
Well, yes, I participated in a co-op when my oldest son was 4 years old. Uh-huh. And then that was at the point where I was beginning to take early childhood courses, mm-hmm. and try them out on him. And then when my second child was about 3 years old, I went to work part-time at Friends School, mm. to help bring some funds into the family. And my mom took care of the oldest was in school already. Mm-hmm. The younger one was 3 years old, and mom took him. It was only 2 days a week. Mm-hmm. And then after that, I moved more and more into teaching longer periods of time.
And were you still with Friends School at that point, or the cooperative when you?
I was with all.
I see. You know. You're involved in a variety of different educational,
right,
settings.
Yeah, very much so. Mm-hmm. But all of them, primarily, I had a strong interest in parent interaction with children and training parents with children. But I would have taken the little kids without parents in it, too. They were wonderful. I miss them dreadfully.
Mm. Well, I don't know. As we were talking earlier, maybe there are some greats in the future someplace.
Well, I don't bend over. Or as one kindergartner once told me, you bend over, fine, Mrs. Carpenter. It's getting up that's hard for you.
They're very candid, aren't they? Indeed. Five-year-olds.
Indeed.
Absolutely. So you had taken some coursework at Towson, but you hadn't done any work-related things with the university yet.
No.
And how did that come to pass?
Oh, that was... seems I kind of back into so much stuff, uh-huh. don't I? Well, while I was working with parent cooperatives, I met two wonderful women who were members of the Towson Unitarian Church, who were very much interested in the East Towson community. And at that point, all of the children from East Towson were going to the black school in the community. And if they were lucky enough somehow to be integrated into the local public school, elementary school, they invariably ended up in special ed children. They were almost from the time they walked in through the school door, they were placed in. And those days, they weren't really special ed classes. They were the classes for the slow learners or the whatever they called them in those days. But anyhow, through these women, and I became very much interested in that community. And at the same time, it happened that we were just now beginning to look to Head Start as a possibility for helping these youngsters to learn better and earlier. And so the two ladies and I wrote a grant for one of the first, if not the first, full-day Head Start community organization mm-hmm. grant in the country, and we got it. And now I had backed myself into a situation where we had to find a place to have a school, and we had to find teachers, and we had to find children. And I can remember walking around through the community and seeing a child who looked as if he was 5 years old and following him home and knocking on the door, and the other ladies were doing the same thing. And we got our group together. And it's a long involved story, isn't it?
Well, it's a very interesting story. Well,
parallel to that, Dr. Kerr had just come to Towson, and he had gotten a grant for Towson to train a group of Head Start teachers, one of the first training programs in the country.
And so he was a member of the Early Childhood Education Department faculty?
Yes. I believe at that time he was already chair of the department. But he had the teachers and I had the children, uh-huh. and his teachers needed to see children. So we met and we agreed that he would bring his teachers to see Head Start children in action. Unfortunately, the calendar was such that he had to bring his teachers the very first day that I was going to be teaching the children. And we were in the basement of the community church, which was not the best kind of a situation for a classroom.
Right.
And so, you know, shortly after school began in the morning, and came Dr. Kerr with his 20 teachers who sat around the perimeter of the room while these children all stared at them, uh-huh. but were too polite to say anything uh-huh. about who are they.
mm-hmm. So the majority of these children were African-American?
They were all African-American.
And I imagine the majority of students coming in with Dr. Kerr were Caucasian.
Possibly half and half. Mm. Dr. Kerr was one of the pioneers in training teachers in Head Start who had a similar background to the children they were going to teach, so that they could understand what these children dealt with in their lives at home. So it was a piece of each. Uh-huh. Where they came from, I don't know. Uh-huh. I have no uh-huh. idea.
But that because that certainly wouldn't have been the profile of most of the students at Towson University.
I don't
at the
think
time.
Any of them were students at Towson University.
Okay.
I believe it was a government grant, and I think he had people coming from perhaps the entire East Coast. Oh, I don't know.
Okay.
I don't remember. Mm-hmm. But
but you survived.
We all survived. We made it, and the program went on. I took the role of director of the program, uh-huh. And there we had three teachers, three, four, and five-year-olds, and we had three aides from the community, uh-huh. Parents, mm-hmm. who had, I don't think any one of them had anything more than elementary education, but I'm so happy and proud to be able to say that one of those women who had been a mother at age 14, when she was with us, she was, I think, about 19, went on to get her degree in early childhood education. She was the director of Homewood Friends Daycare and went on from there to several other directorships and daycare positions.
That's wonderful.
It was wonderful. It was really, really wonderful.
And so how long did you do that?
Well, let's see. I stayed as director for 2 years, mm-hmm. and during that time I was in contact with Dr. Kerr through his training programs. He would send folks over to mm-hmm. observe what was going on. And then in 1969, I guess it was, After my third year as director, I felt strongly it was time for the community to take over the program. Mm-hmm. And so while I was thinking about that, Dr. Kerr was also needing someone to teach part-time here. So I started teaching one night a week, the evening course. And the year after that first year of teaching evenings, Lida Lee Tall position in kindergarten opened up.
Mm-hmm.
And Dr. Kerr asked if I would consider doing a split position, half Lida Lee Tall and half Towson. So I was delighted to do it, and that's how I came to Lida Lee Tall.
Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about Lida Lee Tall.
Lida Lee Tall, I described it as heaven on earth sometimes, although it wasn't always when you had to get up in the morning and go. But you know, Karen, when I was teaching at Towson, so many of the students that I had were seniors, and so many of them were actually graduate students.
Uh-huh.
And always on the last day of school, I would say, you know, the very best I can wish for you is that you will be as happy in your work as I have been in mine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I didn't get up every morning saying, yippee, you know,
right,
go
right
in there. But the good days so far outweighed the bad ones.
Uh-huh.
That I don't remember bad ones. I remember only good ones.
Mm-hmm.
And miss it very, very much. But when I came to Lida Lee Tall, the feeling of caring for the children that I found in the faculty and the faculty's care for one another was just something that you couldn't find very many places.
Mm-hmm.
And the freedom to try what you thought would work best for your children,
mm-hmm,
was there always. I don't remember ever having an administrator say to me, no, you can't do that. I was asked why, and sometimes I could explain, sometimes I couldn't even explain, but there was that, and well, of course, the building to me was just heaven. We had, the first year in particular, we must have been going through some sort of boom at Towson University, because
uh-huh
there wasn't anything that I asked for in the way of equipment or materials that, oh sure, go ahead and buy it.
Wow.
Oh sure. And it's never happened again since.
No.
And then also I liked the idea of, while I had worked with aides before in my mm-hmm teaching, I liked the idea of being able to hire aides from who were students at the university.
Mm.
And at that time, I don't recall, if it had happened, I wasn't aware of it, but I don't think there had ever been any hired aides at Lida Lee Tall School who were also in the university program.
Mm-hmm.
And so I really had, it was such fun. During the 12 years that I was there, I had the opportunity to have three young men,
mm-hmm,
which was a first also, I think, in kindergarten. Three young men come and be aides in the program, and they were fantastic. They were really great. One was an art major, one was a psych major, and one was an education major. And of course, the little boys adored them. The girls
mm-hmm
did too.
Mm-hmm.
They were wonderful help. They were fantastic. One of them, I recall, I had a young student who was the son of Dr. Mitchell in the art department.
Mm-hmm.
And this little boy had to come too. Am I supposed to name our children or not? Is it okay? This youngster came to school
uh-huh
in the morning with his dad. So
uh-huh
he was there before the other kids were there. And what to do with Chris?
Uh-huh.
And so my aide was fascinated by Chris because he was such a bright youngster. He said, I'll come in early and watch him and be with him until, you know, school's ready to begin. And he and Chris had a chess game that they got started in kindergarten that lasted the entire year. Every
wow
morning they played that chess game. And God help anybody who touched that chessboard
mm-hmm
in between. But it was that kind of thing that made the school special, and the students coming in. I just was sorry that I didn't have more time at that point to spend with the college students who were coming in to observe. Uh-huh. It was, you know, they were in and out.
Right.
And when they were gone, since I still had to stay with the children, I couldn't leave the children to you know, sit and talk with them. I often wondered, well, what did they think when so-and-so did this? And what did they think when I did this, mm-hmm. you know? And there wasn't quite enough time for that, which was a shame. Mm-hmm. But at the beginning, we had a lot more students from Towson than we did toward the end of my time there. Mm.
There's, it seems as though towards the end, there was a greater emphasis on research-related projects. Was that so?
That was it. And then there were, interestingly enough and strangely enough, I guess, so many of the students who were education majors wanted to go back to their own elementary school to do their student teaching. I guess that speaks well of the elementary schools, you know. And I would have wanted the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Of course, but, I assume that their first grade teacher, even if she were still there, it wouldn't be quite the same, oh, those many years later, but...
But still, there is that sense of belonging, and I had such a good time here, and all this that goes into it. But since so many of the students wanted to go back to their own school or into the district or county where they wanted to go teach.
Right.
Then Towson acquiesced and tried to help them in every way that they could. And so many, many of the students were, you know, those of us who were doing student teaching supervision were going to down beyond Annapolis and out beyond Falston and all over the place to accommodate these students who wanted to do their student teaching in the community where they wanted to teach, which showed wisdom on their part. Right. I'm not sure how smart we were. But
so Lida Lee Tall came to a close.
Yes. So
not without great effort on many people's part.
Oh my, yes.
To keep the school open.
And you know, it's in my head, I can see so many things that a Lida Lee Tall school could be doing now or could have been doing in the last 15, 20 years. Mm-hmm. I mean, the integration of Latinos into our population has been a real struggle for those folks. And I think we could have done an awful lot in terms of teaching children with a different background, of working with families of these children and helping them to understand some of the crazinesses of our country and our culture. I think of children now who are the subject of so much anxiety, the children who fit in along that long spectrum of autism, which still is not understood, and there's so many different kinds and nuances to that particular illness, if that is what it is, that are affected by education and by teachers, that where places where we could really be doing an awful lot of work, mm-hmm. and it's a tremendous loss. It's a tremendous loss. But there it is.
Mm-hmm. So when Lida Lee Tall closed, that you became a full-time member then of the Department of Early Childhood.
Yep.
And what kinds of things did you do in that role? Well, it sounds like you did some supervision of student teachers.
Supervision of student teachers, and I became under Dr. Marilyn Lewis's administration when she was the chairperson. We were moving into the beginnings of special ed law and special ed programs, and Dr. Lewis asked if I would be willing to try to work with her and set up a special ed, not a program, we weren't really thinking special ed program at all, but simply a course in special education. And with her guidance, I set up the first early introduction to special education course, which then became a required course for anyone throughout, not just early childhood, but students who came from elementary and secondary ed and graduate students. And it became the required course that everyone had to take before they could go out into to teaching. And at the same time, the State Department and the of Education and the Attorney General's office were setting up a system for reviewing cases where the school system and parents of children were not in agreement concerning the either the programs or the placement for their children. And federal and state laws decreed that there would be adjudicators who would listen to the cases and make decisions. And I was lucky enough to be accepted into the training program. And so as after I received the training, I became what was called an impartial hearing officer for the state of Maryland. And I was asked to adjudicate in situations where there was a difference between the school system and a set of parents or a parent. And it was, I heard cases all over the state at that point. So, which was also fascinating. And then had to, the hearing officer had to hear the case impartially and make a decision. And the decisions were always written decisions, which then went on. And they could be appealed. And so far as I know, I don't think a single one of my cases was appealed. How about that? But I don't know. There may have been appeals.
And were you doing that at the same time you were still in the department?
Yes.
Oh, my heavens.
I was. It was, you know, I never, ever took time away from a class to do this. I always assigned, you know, from teaching there were sometimes we didn't have Tuesday or Thursday classes or what have you. That didn't mean we didn't have anything to do, as you know.
Right.
There was always plenty of to do. But I could accept assignments on those days so that I would not be neglecting my teaching. But I hope it was a service. I hope that it did some good.
Yeah. Well, did you get to share what you were learning and your training with
Well, I was still teaching special education, and a number of the cases that I heard were very pertinent to what I was being taught. For instance, if the case had to do with an inappropriate placement, the parents wanted a child at one place, and the school wanted the child at another place, and the placement focused around the services for the child. So often what the school or the parents were asking for was so inappropriate for that particular condition that the child had that it was pretty clear where that child should be. And if that was the case, I would sometimes share the case in class and ask the students, now, you know, what would your decision be? Why would you think that child should be here or there? But never in any way that identified the schools or the children or the families in any way. But I felt it gave some authenticity to the teaching and practicality. And as teachers going out into the school system who were in a position to perhaps have the school very embarrassed by inappropriate placement or teaching, I thought it was important for the students here to know some of that.
Because the chances would be good that at some point they would be sitting on a team of a school team that would make those kinds of decisions or be responsible for implementing those decisions.
And also, I thought, you know, with any of them, and surely they were, all of them, I would think at some point or other, involved in a special ed decision concerning a child. The school system very, very often produced as witnesses classroom teachers. Mm-hmm. And I just felt it was important for them to know what they would be facing if they were in that position. So whether it worked or not, I don't know. I hope. I hope.
Well, now we have a special education major. Now we have a special ed, elementary ed combined major. And now we have a special ed, early childhood combined major.
So, I hadn't thought of it that way before.
Well, and mm-hmm. I think some of that early work that you did really sort of facilitated, if you will, our understanding of the need.
Well, I did make myself very unpopular at school with my colleagues. Kindly unpopular. No one was ever unkind. But I don't think that for some years, some of my colleagues understood that I wasn't just, well, how to put this? The best way I can tell you a story about Dr. Norma Haseman, who was our school psychologist.
At Lida Lee Tall.
At Lida Lee Tall. Norma took me by the hand one day and said, Liz, come sit down. I want to tell you something. I said, yes. And she said, I'm going to tell you what's wrong with you. Uh-huh. I said, oh, good. I thought, man, some people pay a lot of money for this. And she said, you never grew up. And I said, well, you know, maybe you're right. Maybe I never grew up. How do you know that? She said, well, you think the world should be fair, and it isn't. Mm. And I thought a minute, and I thought, she's absolutely right. My father told me to be fair. The world should be fair. And I got up to leave, and she said, wait a minute, I'm not finished with you. And I sat down again. And she said to me, it's not just that you think the world should be fair. You're driving us crazy trying to make it fair. I said, yes, you're right. And what she meant was, I was so anxious that Lida Lee Tall move forward and set an example and start to gain information about mainstreaming children. Uh-huh. And I wanted children to be mainstreamed at Lida Lee Tall. Uh-huh. And the faculty, and I'm sure rightly so in many respects, said, we are not set up for that. We can't do that. They were concerned mostly, I think, about the parents and whether the parents would object to having these children come in. And so I guess as my daughter-in-law said about my grandson one time, I was ramming around trying to convince my colleagues that we ought to do this. Uh-huh. And so I did, I'm sure, make a real pain in the neck to some of them, trying to convince them to do this. But while we were there, I was able to, in my summer program, include a little girl, the first little physically disabled child that I know of who came to Lida Lee Tall. She came into the summer program, and we had a little red wagon. She had spina bifida and could not, and had braces. And we had a little red wagon, and wherever the class went, Alicia went with us because the kids insisted, and they fought to be the person to pull her wagon. And all the children learned how to lock and unlock her braces so that when she wanted to sit down, they could do that for her. And then at just about the same time, Dr. Norma Hauserman was working with children who were placed away from their homes in group situation, institutional situation, that was. And she wanted to bring some of those children to Lida Lee Tall because her feeling was that these children saw only what she called yucky behaviors around them all the time. Mm-hmm. And if they saw appropriate behaviors being modeled for them by other children, mm-hmm. that it would make a difference. Mm-hmm. And again, it was a tough fight, but finally she convinced the administration and the faculty and parents, I'm sure, to allow her to bring some of these children to Lida Lee Tall. Mm-hmm. And for a couple of semesters, there was a bus that pulled up every morning from that institution, and the children were divided out among mm-hmm. their classes. And we tried to see what could be done that way. Unfortunately, funding for the busing and all dropped out, and the program came to an end. But I had one little child in my program. These children were all considerably older than kindergarten age, but mm-hmm. this little boy, I've often thought that he was probably very much abused in many, many ways at home and failed to thrive. He was very small for, mm-hmm. I think he was 11 years old, mm-hmm. but he was the size of my five-year-old children, and very much 5 years rather than 11 years right. in his behaviors. And Joey came into our classroom, and he loved wiping tables. I don't know where he learned to wipe tables, but hmm. Joey was the best table wiper, and the children all commended him about it. And he stayed for just less than a semester, half semester there. And Norma and we all decided it was time for him to go into first grade. He was mm-hmm. ready to go. Well, Joey cried, the children cried, I cried, but it was best for him to go on to first grade. And so we told him, Joey, you know, you can always come see us, and we're always interested in what you're doing. Well, we kept this locker for him, and the children would poke little, some of them would save a cracker from their snack, or somebody would make a picture, or somebody would pick up a caterpillar, or what have you. You never knew what you were going to find in Joey's locker. But for quite some time after he was moved, Joe, when the kids came down the ramp to go to lunch, Joey would peel off from the group, and he'd come in and he'd check that locker to know, you know. And the saddest day for me was when Joey didn't come to his locker anymore. He didn't need it anymore. Mm-hmm. And it was
but it
sad.
Sounds like
it was wonderful, but it was sad. Mm-hmm. No mm-hmm. Joey anymore. But he was a wonderful little boy. You know, what's happened to him.
Yeah.
Don't know.
So how long did that program end because Lida Lee Tall closed?
No, it ended before Lida Lee Tall closed. It was a problem of funding with the bus.
I see.
But the bus brought along not only the children, but some of these children's behaviors are really quite severe.
Uh-huh.
And so each classroom where there was a child or two placed was also given an aide.
I see.
Who came on
uh-huh.
the bus with the children. Uh-huh. So you had the children, you had the bus, you had the aide, and a couple of other staff members came along who were resource persons for us.
Yeah.
So we, Norma was very, very, very knowledgeable in that field. And she knew that we would need resource people.
Uh-huh.
And, so that if a child, for some reason, was having difficulty in class, so that the teacher was able to remain, on task and to be there for the other children, she could call upon, the aide could either go get a resource person or the aide could take the child out.
Uh-huh.
But we had resource persons there with whom we could speak and or who could take the children for us if we needed to. It was a wonderful program.
Well, but very brave on the part of the Lida Lee Tall faculty
to
be willing to take this on. I mean, these were children who lived in a residential setting, mm-hmm. which meant that they were not able to do well in a typical setting.
Absolutely.
That was
the faculty was
kids
you know.
With enormous needs.
Yeah, indeed, and they were, in many ways, maybe even totally, they were wiser than I, because I guess they knew their limitations at that point mm-hmm. and what had not been done. Whereas I said, oh, sure, we can do it. mm-hmm. Yes, these mm-hmm. kids need it. What do you mean we mm-hmm. can't do it? We mm-hmm. can do it. And so I guess the combination of the irritant that I was and their wisdom and years of experience that I hadn't had with little children yet came together, and sometimes there were sparks. Mm-hmm. But we loved each other dearly, and I still can't go past the new building that's there and look at it. I can't. And we still, some of us still meet once
Very
a month.
Nice. Very nice.
Once a year in summer, we meet together and that's laugh wonderful. At one another's foibles, uh-huh. Uh-huh. follow one another's children,
yeah,
and talk about the children that we had. And so.
And do you think that you saw some measure of progress, even though those kids were there such a brief time? I mean, was there anything to suggest that theory that if you put them in a more typical setting, that sort
Without
of would...
Without a doubt. Without okay. a doubt. And it was unfortunate. Well, we got the children too late in some respects.
They were too old?
They were along too far along in years. See. It would have taken more time. Uh-huh. So that it was late in years and not really enough time to become a cohesive kind of program, since we didn't know their families. Mm-hmm. We had no access to their families. Mm-hmm. I'm sure some of the children themselves didn't have access to their families. But if there could have been, and I don't know how we would have fitted into our days, but if there could have been opportunities for our faculty to meet with the folks at the institution who were with them far more than we were, and to be able to make a cohesive program that way, so that, you know, with all of these children with special needs, almost to the last one, consistency is the key.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that if we could have known how the staff responded to certain behaviors, mm-hmm. And we could have worked with them and done the same thing, or said, oh, we don't think so, could we try this and so, it could have been much more successful.
Mm-hmm.
Takes money.
Mm-hmm.
I think there would have been time. I think the staff, all they were, the fact that they were at first so reticent, once the children were there, the faculty gave it their all. Mm-hmm. There's no question in my mind mm-hmm. that all of my colleagues did everything for those children that they had done for any other child. It was a lot of 12 students. But it just wasn't the funding to continue it, which is so sad.
Mm-hmm.
So sad. But the girls were great. And let me just tell you one more thing.
Okay.
In teaching, in schools, so often, I'm sure you've heard this, Karen, you've heard a teacher say, what do they expect me to do with this kid? That teacher had him last year, didn't do a damn thing. You heard that?
Mm-hmm.
I was so lucky with the teacher who had the children before me. She was such an outstanding teacher and so wonderful. Never once crossed my mind to think that I could blame her for anything that I wasn't able to do. Nor did the teacher that they go to my knowledge, ever say, what do you expect me to do? She didn't do anything with them. I never heard that at Lida Lee Tall. Never. Mm-hmm. You got the kids and it was your job.
Mm-hmm.
And you didn't blame the person before you, and the person after you didn't blame you, which you don't find very often. I mean, mm-hmm. it that was really remarkable.
It is.
It was really, really great.
Oh. So Lida Lee Tall closed, and you did a little bit more teaching for Towson.
Yes, And I think I'd still be teaching Karen if I could still keep it all together. I stopped only because my husband became very ill and mm-hmm. I needed to be at home mm-hmm. with him. But while I miss all of my teaching, I miss the children the most, the Lida Lee Tall. Mm. That I miss more than anything I've ever missed in my life, really. Mm. They're special guys, all of them. All of them.
What would you say to someone? I mean, what wisdom would you give to individuals who are interested in a career in teaching?
I would say, for me, it was the most wonderful thing in the world. It can be the most wonderful thing in the world. And if it isn't, don't do it. It's tremendous responsibility. You're shaping lives, you're affecting attitudes. You touch families, you touch communities. It's a tremendous responsibility, and yet it can be such fun and so rewarding. It's hard, hard work, but you don't mind the hard work. I mean, it's all part of what you're doing. But don't do it if you don't. And I don't mean yippee every day. Mm-hmm. I mean just at the end of the day, the semester, not even the day, day's too short time. At the end of the semester and your kids are going on to another group, if you don't cry a little bit because those kids are going, then maybe you ought to reconsider uh-huh. teaching. But in the last day of school, Lida Lee Tall was a bummer. You've never seen so many crying women in your life. All of us. And we knew they were only going to the room next door. We were going to see them next
but
year.
But they weren't going to be yours.
They weren't going to be yours anymore. It's crazy. We used to have some wonderful last day picnics, too. Did any of the other folks you talked to tell you about the last day picnic?
No, tell us about that.
Oh, the last day of school was always great fun. The faculty played the graduating sixth graders in softball. And then we'd have...
And who usually won?
The kids, of course. The kids. But we would have a half-day school. Mm-hmm. And the second half, we would have our softball. We cleaned our rooms, got everything mm-hmm. done that needed to be done and straightened out for the next group of children who were going to be coming. Wasn't it nice when you came and the room was mm-hmm. clean and pretty? Now let's get it ready for somebody else. We did all that, and then in the afternoon, parents came with dinner for the teachers. They brought dinner for the teachers, and they would watch the softball game, mm-hmm. and then we'd have dinner, mm-hmm. and then we'd have our cry. We'd all go home. But speaking of dinner, Karen, one of the nicest things that happened to me when I was teaching, it must have been at the time when I was trying to do my training for impartial hearing officer and a couple other things. You know how sometimes your life gets crazy. And it was in the morning, one of the mothers who carpooled her children to school, and mothers, lots of mothers did, and they almost always stopped and talked for a little mm-hmm. bit. And one of the mothers came in and chat for a little bit, and she said, "You look tired." I said, "Yeah, I am tired today." But I said, "I'll be fine, you know, as soon as the kids get here, and things will be great." So at lunchtime, we had half-day kindergarten, and at lunchtime, when she came back to pick up the children, she had a basket with her, and in the basket, she had a pot of spaghetti sauce mm-hmm. and a tossed salad, a box of spaghetti, a loaf of bread, and a bottle of wine. And she had gone to the other mothers and said, "You know, this Liz is tired, and let's get dinner for her. And so they'd all pitched in, and when she came back here, was a basket. Now, where else would that have happened? Mm-hmm. Where mm-hmm. else could that have happened? Mm-hmm. It was just fantastic. My family loved it, too.
I'm sure.
Yeah. That's another thing, too, about Lida Lee Tall. It was a school that involved the teachers' families. My husband made more wooden reeds for the kids to put nuts on and you know, all sorts of science and art projects every year. All of our husbands were involved in stuff like that. On my street, the kids all collected more trash than you can imagine to put in a basket that I kept on the back porch for Mrs. Carpenter's kindergarten. I mean, there would be, you know, empty baby food jars and egg crates and all mm-hmm. kinds of stuff, because they're really dandy to use in kindergarten. Mm-hmm. And so all the community was throwing stuff into that. So it was community.
Yeah.
It was great.
Is there anything we missed?
How could there be? I didn't shut up the whole time.
It was wonderful.
There's so much I would love to tell you about Lida Lee Tall. It's special. It's mm-hmm. special. And there'll never be another.
Oh, we don't know that.
I wish I could believe.
We can hope.
We can hope, yeah. I'm sure. I'm sure that, you know, the world hasn't come to an end. No. It's just an error.
Yes.
And I just wish we could see more of the children who were there. My son has a new friend who plays music with him uh-huh. on our back porch uh-huh. one night a week, who is new to the group that has been meeting for quite a while. And when I went out to meet this young man, my son said to me, "Mom, this is my new friend, Timmy Riggleman." And I looked at this 6'4" huge man. I said, "Timmy Riggleman, did you go to Lida Lee Tall kindergarten?" He said, "Yeah, I did." And I said, "I taught you." And he said, "Oh, you're that carpenter." And I said, "Yes." And I said, after a while, we chatted. One day afterwards, I said to him, "Timmy, what did you like about kindergarten and what didn't you like about it?" He said, it was great. He says, "I like kindergarten, except you made me take a rest every day." And he had been a very active kid, and he didn't like that rest period. Little did they know I needed it.
As much as the kids.
More probably.
Well, thank you very much for doing this.
You're more than welcome, I'm sure, Karen. Thank you for asking me.